It's titled The Practitioner, or rather it's titled To Be For Practitioner, largely because when I put together this lecture, I titled it The Essence of Dhamma. And when we talk about the essence of Dhamma, really, Dhamma is about the practice. It's about people's life and how they can experience Dhamma for themselves and be happy. Dhamma is about developing the mind so that the mind is able to be happy. It's a 6-week series, and if you can, you may want to attend all the weeks because they're all connected. Otherwise, you have a gap in the series, okay? So today's talk deals with an explanation of who the Buddha was and what he stood for. Why do we want to talk about the Buddha? And the reason is because if you look at your own definition of what is your belief, you call yourself a Buddhist, i.e., I believe in what the Buddha had taught. Then the next question is, what did he teach? But before we get there to what he had taught, you have to first ask yourself, who was he? What was he? Are we so sure he existed? Do we know? I mean, it was a long time ago. If someone tells you something about last week or the week before, you start to question, over time you start to wonder, true or not. And as it goes further and further back, you go, is serious or not? This one is a long time ago, you know? It's 2,500 years ago. So do we know whether he existed? How do we know that he existed? And once we have established his existence, then we go on to talk about what he had taught. What we understand, accept, embrace to be Buddhism was what he left behind. His definition of what is reality, what is the world, his explanation of what should be our priorities in life, what's important, what is not. His explanation of, at the end of the day, what's the meaning of life? How do you be truly happy in this life? How do we escape, get away from dukkha? Subsequently, I'll explain dukkha. Today, we just leave it at that first. And then how do we know he's right? This is his explanation of the reality of the world. His explanation of the world. How do we know he was right? First, who was the Buddha? The evidence come from essentially three sources. One, Asoka's archaeological findings, remains. Asoka, Emperor Asoka, lived round about 200 over years after the historical Buddha. And 200 over years after historical Buddha, in the context of your own time, you think of it like this, huh? Today, 21st century. 200 plus years back, slightly after the American War of Independence. It is also a long time ago. So around about the century, even before Abraham Lincoln was freeing the slaves in the States. It's a long time ago, okay? So Asoka lived in a time about 200 plus years after the life after the historical Buddha. And what we know from those remains, those stone tablets, those pillars that he left behind, what we know from those evidence was that about 200 plus years ago, there was an individual. He was a famous teacher, very famous teacher. He had a lot of students. He taught a particular philosophy, which by the time of Asoka, it was still very popular. We know that this individual was born in Lumbini, because Asoka went to Lumbini and proclaimed that he was all for Buddhism. We also know that the teaching that he left behind was still very much followed during the time of Asoka. So, at the very least, 200 years after the historical Buddha, there was still archaeological evidence of that individual. The next source of information comes from the canon, not just the Pali canon. Pali canon is the canon of the Theravadin school. There were also canon from other schools and from all these canons. Now, you must understand India was big. India not small like Singapore. India is huge. And ancient India, in the minds of the people then, would have seemed even larger. Yes? Why? Because today you can fly from one city to another, ma. In the old days, you could walk for many, 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 many weeks before you get from point A to the next big city or town. What does this mean? If you have schools spread across India carrying documentation of a person and his teaching, fairly okay to accept that there must be such an individual with such teaching, ma? Yes? After all, it's spread over a wide distance. Impossible for one area to infect another had it not been for a central source from which emitted that teaching. Yes? And then what do we know from the canon? Let's just take the Pali canon because it's the most complete set. If you go by the Pali canon, what do we know of this individual? We know from the Buddha's own words that he originated from the foothills of the Himalayas. We know that. We know that he came from a particular clan, tribe called the Sakyans, very famous apparently, very rich, had large tracts of land, very privileged. And he himself said he grew up in very pampered surroundings. In my book, I wrote that the lotus in his ponds are color-coded. He's got yellow, blue and white lotus. Ponds for blue lotus, ponds for white lotus, they're color-coded. He has got three palaces, he said, not I say, he said, three palaces built for him by his father, one for each season. Presumably, the wet season one would be high, the hot season one will have a high roof, so it gets cooler, etc., etc. We know that he married. We don't know when he married, but we know he did. We don't know his wife's name, not in the Pali canon, but in the commentaries, they're very happy to tell you she's got many names, including Yasodhara that you know of. We know he had a son, and we know he left this very pampered lay life for a very hard life as an ascetic, a homeless ascetic. This came from the Buddha himself, captured in the Pali canon. If you had read the book, which I think some of you had, you would know that much of what we know about Buddha's life was probably not so correct. It's a lot culled from commentaries. We can't verify those. But there are some things that we can verify if we accept that the Pali canon was accurate in capturing him, his life. And from those that we could verify from the Pali canon, it's still a very, very interesting life. I actually wrote one book and another one is coming out. So there's going to be two books on this life. Very fascinating life. And a very difficult one, very tough life. When he made his decision to leave his house, his own explanation for why he left was that he found lay life unconducive for spiritual practice. He didn't say he saw four sights, which you are most familiar with. He merely said lay life impossible to practice. And for that sense of the meaninglessness of a lay life, the pain of a lay life, he decided to leave and go in search of what's happiness and the manner, the way to achieve that, to attain, to taste that. Not just the happiness of being alive, enjoying sense bases, but unconditioned happiness, unconditioned joy. What do we mean by unconditioned happiness? Our sense of what's happiness, our sense, it's all conditioned. I get a promotion, happy like a lark. My wife gave birth, laggy happy. I strike 4D, won the World Cup, predicted Brazil got beaten 7-0, happier, 15,000 what, happy right? All conditioned, depending on external factors, which you can't control, which you cannot determine. Unconditioned happiness is when there is a joy that comes from within and does not depend on external condition. It's a joy that comes from within. People look at you, may see you, oh, it's a bit siao leh. Who's smiling like that one? What's that to smile? But like that, oh, this is the way they experience life. So he was, when he left home, he was going in search of how to taste, how to reach, how to experience unconditioned happiness. But the good thing about sitting here is I can read. The bad thing about walking around is I can't read. So you get to read, you get to hear a little bit more. Okay, spiritual life quit. Okay, after he left home, we know that he spent 6 years-ish, plus minus, struggling to understand. And he checked out two different types of practice. Of the day, there were two different types. One type, which a lot of us here may go into, we call it the yogi practice. You sit, you meditate, you focus the mind. That's all. Sit, meditate, focus the mind. He checked out the two famous schools, like all of us. You see, Buddha was not presumptuous. Buddha didn't presume that he was going to live the lay life, set up a school, become a famous teacher. Yes, he didn't. He didn't assume that. He assumed he was going to learn from somebody. So when he left home, he went off to check out the two famous teachers. So he checked one after another. He didn't check out both at the same time. Some of us might, but he didn't. Okay, one after another, he tried. Very advanced level of meditation. If you're familiar with meditation, you'll know that these two taught him to the highest level of meditations. Didn't work. You see, it is extremely important in your own search, you know that you know what you're looking for. It's very important. Because if you don't know what you're looking for, you get yourself stuck in a ditch, end up in the wrong place, you also don't know it's Salah. Yes? Ah, oh, I want to go somewhere. I also don't know where I want to go, but never mind, I hear so good. So that can happen. Buddha was different. Buddha knew what he was looking for. Buddha was looking for happiness and the way to realize that. Unconditioned happiness, yes? So he knew what he wanted. So when he did his meditation, he knew it didn't lead him there. Yes, you go deep into meditation, you're very happy. The moment you come out of meditation, not so happy. Really. Eventually, it all dissipates. So he knew that that wasn't the answer. Something else might be the answer. So he left. He left these two. Even though he was so good, he was their star pupil, they wanted to offer him joint leadership. Hey, not bad. Just a few weeks old, ascetic, practice very well, and then start, be my joint CEO of my school. He said no. That was not what he wanted. After all, he could have stayed on as chairman of the Sakyan board, but he didn't want. Right? So he went off and he did the next thing of the day. The second practice was torture your body. And we know Buddha was star of everything. So even when it came to torturing his body, he was really good at it. And he did it so well, he almost died. I honestly, if you listen to his description, you go back to the original text, it tells you he turned black. Who turns black? Seriously, you are completely dehydrated. You are just half a skeleton left. Not even a full skeleton. So it was really, really bad. He almost killed himself. Lucky for us, lucky for world history, he pulled back from the brink. He said, hey, something is wrong here. I'm dying and nothing's working. So he pulled back. And then he thought about it, reflected. I think he must have reflected, took a while. And then he concluded that it's the meditation method where the answer lies. But it has to be done more carefully, because what happens is when you go deep in meditation, something happens to the mind. Something happens in the mind, to the mind. And he remembered he had an earlier experience. What could happen? Decided, check it out again. But because the body was so decimated, so so weak, so frail, he had to go back to eating and then get himself engine start again to do the practice, the meditation practice. Okay? Now, I don't want to go into a story of the life of the Buddha, because this is not about the life of the Buddha. This is about who and what was the Buddha. So I shall move on. We all know he was enlightened at a certain time, at about 35. And then from then on, for the next 45 years, he started teaching Dhamma. I just want to pause a little to explain what is enlightenment. Just to be clear about this. The main thing about enlightenment, the main thing was gaining a particular type of knowledge. He called it in Pali, Asavaka Kaya, Kaya. A-S-A-V-A-K-H-A-Y-E. Destruction of the cankers, destruction of defilements, pollutants. Knowledge, gaining the knowledge of how to destroy certain pollutants in the mind that hold the mind to life after life of rebirths. Gaining the knowledge on how to destroy those pollutants, cankers that hold the mind to the to bind the mind to rebirths. And there are three types. In this particular sutta, he talks about three types of cankers. Kama asava, bhava asava, avijja asava. Okay, kama asavas. The cankers of sensual delight, sensual attachment, sensual cankers. Meaning to say, and if you go deep into meditation, you see it. You hear sound. Yes? I must say yes, because you're sitting up here hearing, ma? Listening? Yeah, yes. You see things. Yes? You smell things. Taste. Experience touch. Tactile experience. And you enjoy them? Yes? Don't pretend. Generally, people do enjoy all these sensual. It's okay to enjoy. If you are not enjoying, then you'll be jumping off the next building. Seriously. Because life is so meaningless, I don't enjoy a single thing in life, then you're all. But if you enjoy the sensual delights, it's what keep you hooked to life. Hook, nail, chain to life, because we like to live, and we know that through living we experience senses. Nice. Yes? No need to feel regretful. It's normal. So happily say yes, it's normal, okay? If it's not, if you say no la, I really don't enjoy life, then not quite right, something is wrong here. The next one is cankers of being. If you are drowning in a sea, you will feel this very intensely. You want to be alive, of being alive. If someone tries to suffocate you, you're going to fight back. Because the instinct to survive, the instinct to live, is there. It's very normal. But it's all built-in instinct. It's not your fault. It's all built-in instincts here, okay? And the third one is a canker of ignorance. There you go, huh? Ignorance is a canker? Yeah. I tell you why. How many of you have sat through many Dhamma classes? Well, you're never first class. You attend talks after talks, right? Read all of Dhamma books, right? Check Wikipedia, right? Read Access to Insight. Huh? Some of you more advanced go for retreat. How many of you have gone for retreats, the executive retreats? There you are, so many of you. Now, you must then have also experienced and realized for yourself that when you cling, there is dukkha, yes? You know it, right? Then why you cling? That's clinging to ignorance, ma. We know the more we want, the more we hold, the more 我要, the more dukkha, yes? The more sense of dukkha, the more sense of stress, the more sense of pain. But never mind, never mind. Tomorrow they try to resolve it. Today we just cling on. That's a form of clinging to ignorance. You know and still you do it. But it's normal, it's okay. Everyone else got this problem. It's normal. Okay? Now, all these cankers, you ask yourself, how to break the habit of holding? And Buddha, in deep meditation, when he realized for himself how to break all these cankers, break all this habit, break all these instincts, that was when he realized. That was enlightenment. Okay? Okay, what was the Buddha? This slide, it's about how an individual is seen. If I were to ask you, who are you? What would you say? You will say, my name is so and so. I live where and where. I am how old for the man? I am about 30% younger for the woman. 30% if you really want to be helpful. I have how many kids? And so on and so forth. You describe yourself. And that's how you define who you are. But I flipped the question around and asked you, what are you? That's where it gets a bit problematic. What are you? And almost automatically you go into the role that you play in life. I'm a teacher. I'm a mother. I'm so and so. I do such and such a thing. I'm the CEO of Buddhist Fellowship. I'm not, but as an example, okay? So the question then is, what was the Buddha? Earlier on, we talked about who was the Buddha. Now we ask ourselves, what was he? And I pull out this one. You recited this earlier, yes? Of course, if you didn't, never mind. Now you can. But I put the English words right next to the Pali word. And I wanted to explain this. In the time of the Buddha, this was his calling card. This tells people, or told people then, what he was. Today, we kind of happily chant it as part of ritual. But in the old days, if they had printed calling cards, name cards, at the back it would be say, Arahant, Sammasambuddho, Vichara, Sampanno, etc. because that was how his contemporaries knew him. And what does this mean? Okay, I will just take you through the English words, and then later I'll explain to you collectively what do they mean, what do they tell us about what was the Buddha. He was noble, Arahan. Sammasambuddho, you know, means fully enlightened. By this phrase, we say, or it is implied that he knew the answers to the questions that he was asking. He knew it. He knew it all. He knew what it was. He knew how to do it, how to solve the problem, and he knew how to teach. He knew the spectrum, okay? This is about knowledge. Vidya charana sampanno. Sampanno is possessed of. Vidya is knowledge. Charana, conduct. So, possessed of wisdom and virtuous conduct. It means this individual, known to his contemporary as someone who was very wise, very intelligent, worthy of being consulted, in other words, and a good man, virtuous. Sometimes we know of people who are very intelligent, but not necessarily good. And then you also know of people who are good, but not necessarily intelligent. Buddha had both, okay? Sugato, well-traveled. Not, it doesn't mean jet-setter, frequent flyer, no, it doesn't mean that. Meaning he travels a lot, no. It means he had completed his spiritual journey well. Practice well. It was a good journey, okay? Lokavidu, I love this one. Loka means the world. Vidu, someone who knows the world. And then you go, okay, what does that mean? It means he understands the mind. The world, as far as Buddha is concerned, the world, it's in your mind. Take away your mind and you have no world, because you're not aware of the world anymore. Give you a mind and give someone else a mind, you have a very different sense of the world. You see what I'm saying? But he is someone who understands the mind. Of course, another explanation for this phrase is that he knows the different worlds. They are literal about it. You know, the heavenly world, the human world, the animal world. Okay? I prefer the other explanation. I think it makes a little bit more sense. But you can choose either. It's okay. If you were taking an exam, you can write both and happily say, I choose this one, but it can also mean that one. But since you're not taking an exam, it's okay. Anuttaro Purisadhammasarati. Anuttaro, incomparable. Purisadhamma. Man. Sarati, leader. Tame. To be tamed. So this is someone who is able to help individual tame their minds. Tame the mind. If you had opportunity to look at your own mind, you will know, chances are, your mind would need a little bit of taming. Put it under control. Huh? It's okay to admit that we all have that problem. But the next one is interesting. Satta Deva Manusanam, teachers of gods and men. Deva, you know, is God. Satta is man. Manusana is man. Satta is teacher. Now, why say that he was a teacher of men and gods? What about others? So from this phrase alone, it does suggest that in the human realm, no problem learning the Dhamma. The Deva realm, also no problem learning the Dhamma. Otherwise, why call him a teacher of gods and men? So for those of you who believe that when you become a Deva, you got no chance to practice Dhamma, not true, huh? This one doesn't say so, okay? But it also means that if you are an animal, a bit difficult. I mean, you know, trying to explain Dhamma to the dog. Dukkha. Dog ain't going to be very pleased with you. And if you're in hell, I mean, seriously, you're in hell. You got more important things to worry about. And if you're a ghost, you're just basically hanging around. Hanging around. You're not just hanging around listening to Dhamma talk, you know. When Dhamma is being presented, men will be there. Because usually when Buddha talk Dhamma, it's to talk to men. If not, the Devas will be there. Le mo tan kaya. If you are a ghost, hello, you're going to stand where? You stand out there. It's very difficult. Very, very difficult. Okay? Hence, teachers of gods and men. Enlightened and blessed. Okay? Wait, What was the Buddha? Let me take you through it. Starting from inside, I've written it in a sort of correct order. But let me just flip it around a little. You just look at this and I'll flip it around a little. I'm starting from outside in. What does the world know the Buddha to be? The world knows the Buddha to be a teacher. A teacher par excellence. Extraordinaire. Teachers of gods and men, incomparable tamer of those to be tamed, tells you two qualities about his teaching abilities. He can teach anything. As long as your mind is open, you're prepared to listen, you're human, you're prepared to listen, keep it open, keep it soft, he should be able to make an impact in your mind. And he is very skillful in knowing how to guide you along. We know of many teachers who can talk very well, and many teachers who can guide very, very well, but sometimes not tailor-made. Like one size fits all, you know, you go to Metro, then you go buy clothes. They're all is medium, small, large, super large. And super small, go to the baby counter, children counter. One size fits all. Buddha can tailor-made. He's the one who is able to come up with something that is specially for you, made for you. And then it will help you to understand, realize. So, teacher. And what does that mean? It means that you want to honor your teacher, you want to honor the Buddha, then practice and realize. As he put it, as the Buddha put it, those who honored him best were the ones who practiced hard to realize Nibbana. This he said towards the end of his life. Book 2. It will appear there. Okay? The teacher. Next. The wise sage. Part of his reputation, part of the Buddha's reputation, was he could answer any question. He chose not to answer some questions. He did. But he has a method of answering all kinds of questions, and he could have. Why didn't he answer some? Because the start point of those questions was problematic. Meaning to say, the person who asked the question, for instance, did the Buddha live after he passed away? After Parinibbana, was he alive? Was he not alive? Was he neither alive or not alive? Seriously, what's your start point? Your start point is there is something concrete, some essence called the Buddha. That's your start point. No matter how the Buddha answer, it's going to run smack into your starting premise. And your starting premise was already wrong. And when your starting premise is wrong, how to answer? Problem. So, no. Too complicated. You won't understand. You don't have what it takes to understand. No matter what he said, you're going to be confused. And over generations, it's going to be a mess. Even though he didn't answer, it's still a mess. Imagine if he had answered. Okay. So, it is known in his time that he didn't only answer Dhamma question. All kinds of lay people go to him with their marital problems, financial planning problems. But some of them quite good. They'll go and say to him, hey, teach me how to be a good person. That's a good question. Pasenadi is known to go to him. Pasenadi, King Pasenadi, his good friend, was known to go to him and talk about his marital problem. I quarrel with Malika today. Buddha say, yeah. It's normal. So that happens, okay? Both the mundane questions as well as the spiritual questions handled. And above all, most importantly, is he was able to give answer that guide the individual to heaven. Meaning to say, and this is something I do believe in, if one day you want to be a Dhamma teacher, if you want to share Dhamma advice with friends, whatever that you share must help another to improve and guide the person to heaven. No suka guide them to hell. That one not so good, eh? Okay? Because in spirituality, when you're talking about spirituality, it is an attempt to alleviate the mind, make it better, make it more peaceful. And when the mind is more peaceful, when the mind is happier, when the mind has got nothing disturbing, it's shaking its conscience, the mind lives, and can grow. And if you happen to die in that kind of a mental state, that's when you end up in heaven. Get it? So that's how you get to heaven. Okay, we talk about the sage, we talk about the teacher, now we talk about, we're going inwards, the practitioner. We know the Buddha, and the world knew the Buddha to be a practitioner. Meaning what? Throughout his life, even after enlightenment, Buddha still meditated whenever he had the time. We know that he slept very little, and we know that he did walking meditation a lot. Walking meditation. Initially, it was pure meditation. Subsequently, when his health wasn't so good, Jivaka, the physician, the Johns Hopkins physician, told him, Buddha, you must exercise. And also told the monks to exercise. And then they made it as part of their exercise regime to do walking meditation. We know that the Buddha went into jhana regularly. Why is jhana so important? You want to understand the nature of the mind, you need to be able to see the mind. You need to be able to understand how the mind works. And it's only, my personal view, it's only in jhana, regular practice of jhana, concentration meditation, that's not called jhana, this is called deep concentration meditation, then the mind is sharper and better able to see itself properly, okay? Buddha did that regularly. So for those of you who are enlightened, remember, I must continue practicing. So Buddha also did that, okay? Let's see, practitioner, the good and noble man. He was a morally pure being. Why do we say that? You see, this one I ask that you look inwards, into yourself, at yourself. You think about it. Would you say that you sort of got luba, craving? Yes? You all don't have? Oh God, a bit of luba have? Just a bit, because you're a good person. How many of us here would say that we also got a little bit of dosa, anger? Got. So we are average lah. And of course we have moha, because if we have no moha, then we all realize, okay? So we got a bit of moha. So we are loba, we have dosa, we are moha. We are average. Usually I call us all national average. Which is a good thing, you know? National average is a good word. It's when you are below national average, then it's not so good. It means you have more than everyone else individually has. Buddha has none. He has no loba, he has no craving, no arising of craving. Not just no craving. Some of us on a good day has no craving. Walk into ice cream shop, never mind, I'm not in the mood for ice cream today. Yeah? Feeling so good about ourselves, no craving. Just on that day you don't have lah. On another day, you might have. But Buddha has no arising of craving. Because there isn't arising of craving, there is no arising of anger either. You understand? And of course, he has wisdom, perfect wisdom. So no moha. Given that there is no loba, dosa, moha, how much purer can a person get? Whatever that he did, has no eye in it, has no mind in it. How much purer can one get? And because of that, people knew, you see. His reputation in his time was that he was a very good, completely upright character, and he had no self. Because that was his reputation, his enemies, when they wanted to attack him, what did they do? They had to prove that he was not pure, that he had loba, that he was just national average. They only have to prove that he was national average, and it was enough to hurt his reputation. Can you see that? Next book, not this one. And we know that he was enlightened. This is deep insight. The most important definition in our context today is that Buddha was enlightened because he was enlightened, then what he taught, we want to know. If he had not been enlightened, I mean, if he were a good man, that he was a good teacher, that he could teach anything, anyone, he was very wise, what's the use? It's all past tense. Yes, we can learn from him. We can learn how to be a good person. We can learn how the way to heaven. But we don't know for sure whether what we are learning is going to take us anywhere definitive. But because we believe that he was enlightened, then we want to know. That's the most important one in our context. Noah, you've never asked yourself because you never thought of asking? Or you never asked yourself because you're sotapanna, you have no more doubt? Or you never asked yourself because everybody says so more? Huh? Okay, think about this. I don't need you to raise your hand and tell me the answer. Just think about this, okay? How do we know that the Buddha was right? The teaching that he gave, that he left behind, that teaching can be verified. That's how you know for yourself if he was right. Then you need to go back to the starting point. What was the starting point? Happiness. Don't keep saying suffering. starting point is the flip side of happiness. Okay? No suffering. His starting point was, how do you get to a state where the mind does not have dukkha? That's the point. How do you get to a state where the mind does not experience dukkha? That's his starting point. So when someone asked you what the Buddha teach, you don't keep saying suffering. No, he didn't. He taught us how to resolve suffering, if you insist on using suffering to replace the word dukkha. And because that was his starting point, that was his start point, then if you were to follow his method, do what he said you should, if you were to do that, are you feeling the relief? Do you feel better? In other words, we all have this. How many of you have fallen sick once, at least once in your lifetime? As in the body, not the mind. God lah, I should see all the hands up before the Buddha if I tell the truth. So everyone here would have like got cough, got cold. More importantly, have you all seen a doctor? When you saw the doctor, right? You took the medicine, right? And it sort of helped, right? That's why you went back to the doctor again the next time you have fallen sick. Yes? Meaning to say, if the medicine works, you will do it again. Yes? And that's what this method is about. If you practiced it, you should feel better. Your life, your sense of the life, your sense of life should be better. You should be happier as a person. You should feel a bit more relief. When you get into what I call, you see, a normal state, and I think you agree with me, the normal state should be a neutral state. Meaning, you shouldn't be too angry. You shouldn't be too stressed. You shouldn't be so restless. You instead should be feeling somewhat at peace, somewhat quiet. Quite pleasant. People talk to you, you will smile. Instead, growl and growl at people. Agree? That should be sort of a normal state. Because if you tell me that's not the normal state, hey, what practice have you been doing, man? So you know for yourself, actually you do. You know for yourself that when you are feeling bosong, it's not a good day, and it's not the right thing. Yes? Nod a bit more lah. Yeah. Ask you to raise your hand, don't want to raise your hand. Ask you to nod. Can I? Never can, easy. This one, the head won't drop off, don't worry. I guarantee. Okay, you think about it. When you're feeling a little bit bosong, you don't feel good, right? And you feel that that's not normal. Yes? Yeah. Thank you. Then you quickly want to get normal, yes? So you say, go shopping. I call handphone, talk to a friend. This is like how to be a millionaire or how to don't know what millionaire. Call a friend, chit-chat, hopefully raise the mood again. How many of you say, I go read a Dhamma book? Not many. Very good. How many of you say, I'll sit and meditate? That's very good. Attend a Dhamma talk. That's really so good, okay? But seriously, you know, when you're not feeling so good, when you don't feel shook, you know that your mood is, you will say it, even you yourself will say, my mood is off today. Yes? You see? Now, if your mood is off every day, if my mood is off every day, you know your life is running into trouble. You either go call somebody for help, or you go and quietly fix an appointment with a psychiatrist. A problem. But if you are a practitioner, And you say, I cannot go see doctor, very shy. I can't call friend, I got no friends. That's why you're so sad. So, so I think I will check out the Dhamma. I will go and read the Dhamma. So you go to read the Dhamma, then you practice, you go for a retreat, very dukkha, but eventually you crossed it and you got better. You really practice well. You got incentive to practice well, okay? Then what happened? You start to feel better. That is when you say, Dhamma works. Get it? The medicine, however bitter, I guarantee the medicine is bitter. For a period, it will be bitter. But the main thing is, 先苦后甜. My Mandarin is improving, okay? Don't laugh at me. 先苦后甜, it gets better. And because it gets better, if you're practicing correctly and you're practicing well, then what do you say? Dhamma works. You swear blind the Buddha's teaching. That's where faith is anchored. That's what this phrase means. Directly visible, known by direct experience. You know, you see, experience for yourself. Immediately effective, what does it mean? Suppose, let's say, you are feeling very down. Feeling very down. Try, feeling down a bit. Okay, feeling very down. And then, suddenly you saw, you can feel in yourself the mood change. Through not your doing, you're just looking at the feeling of down, and then the mood change. Then you know at that point that you are seeing impermanence. The mood shifted from down to rising, like share market, going up, rising, feeling better. Impermanent, you said. Impermanent. At that moment, you say impermanent, you feel better. And at that moment, you knew for yourself, Buddha kept saying impermanent, impermanent. Now you see it for yourself. You feel the joy. That is immediate. So the point is, any point when you taste the Dhamma, any point when you understood an aspect, a small, no matter how small, an aspect of the Dhamma, at any point, you feel it, you see it, you taste it, no matter how small, even when you're reading Wikipedia and you understood something in that Wikipedia thing, that is immediately experienced. For you, it's timeless. Do you clock? 60 seconds. I finally realized 60 seconds. No, I didn't. You didn't. Straight away. It's immediate. And this phrase, Ehi Pasiko, I know your, what's that? Magazine or singing song or what? Singing song. It's called Ehi Pasiko. This phrase, yes, it means come and see for yourself. But there is another meaning beneath it. If you think about it, you're inviting someone to see for themselves yourself. Yourself, you're inviting yourself, opening your mind, allowing yourself to see it. Allowing yourself, it's not the Buddha calling you to come. It's you yourself making a choice to go forward and see the Dhamma. So a choice and the effort. You have to make the effort. It doesn't drop on your lap. Apple doesn't fall from trees just like that. You got to do something about it. You understand? So about the Dhamma, you need to, it can be tasted, it's experienced by the individual. The effects are immediate, but you have to make a choice to want to do it. You cannot say, may I gain wisdom, then do nothing. Just wait for wisdom to hit you. Something hits you, but I'm not sure if it's wisdom. And then the moment you start to understand, it builds. Opanaiko. it builds. So it is not one moment, singular moment of realization, Nibbana. Time of the Buddha, yes. Today a bit harder, much harder. It's gradual gaining of understanding, deepening of wisdom. And every step of the way, you know. You must know. If you don't know, something is growing. I'm not sure if it's wisdom. You understand? You have to understand. You have to know for yourself that you are changing, that you are transforming. And that the more you walk in the Dhamma, the more you experience the Dhamma, the more you grow as a good being, as a good person. And the happier you are. At the big yardstick is how happy you are. If you say, I'm growing sadder, I got problem. Better come talk to me afterwards. You go outside, talk. Got problem, because something is growing, but it's not Dhamma, okay? Maybe Mara, the other one. Unfortunately, and that's the last bit, which is very true. Directly known through intuitive insight by the wise. It's intuitive. Intuitive. And you have to have some degree of wisdom. In subsequent talks, I will explain by Buddha's definition what's wisdom. So the first way of knowing that he was right is you taste the Dhamma for yourself. Every time you make use of what the Buddha taught to make yourself feel better, to help your mind heal, you know his method works. Every time you do that, you know his method works. But you haven't tasted Nibbana. Or at least, let's not be presumptuous, most of us haven't tasted Nibbana, yes? You have? I think it's okay lah. It's okay. Most of us probably haven't. Then how do we know he's right? All we have is like a feel good, feel bad, then feel good. And in fact, today, honestly, today, there are many, we know that Western countries have adopted mindfulness practice as a healing method for people with some kinds of mental issues. Not illness, lah. Issues. Because we have physical issues, we have emotional issues. It's a more neutral word, and we have got mental issues. So we know that they are starting to use this method to try and heal the mind. I read something from Ayakema yesterday, and I thought she made it. It was a beautiful phrase. She said that a lot of us, when we have physical problems, we run for the doctor, we get it treated quickly. But really, how many of us have actually spent time to try and help the body, to help the mind? We forget to pay attention to looking after the mind. And by not meditating, you're not looking after your mind. That's basically the point. Okay, now, so how do we know that the method works to take you to Nibbana? That there is a destination? And that the destination exists, because we have never been there. It's almost saying that there is utopia, but sorry, I haven't been there. Never mind, trust me, got utopia. And we know that because of this, what is written up here, the Sangha. Sangha, according to the Buddha's teaching, it's not just the people who are in robes They are practitioners who seek enlightenment knowledge and realization of Nibbana. It is not what you wear, it is what you seek to do. And if you seek to realize for yourself the Dhamma, taste Nibbana, it's what you want, then you are sort of belong to the category of the Sangha. Now, let me just read to you what the Buddha said, the Buddha's definition of what makes a bhikkhu, okay? Dhammapada verse 361, Buddha said, restrain in body is good. Good is restrain in speech. Restrain in mind is good. Good is restrain in all the senses. A bhikkhu, restrained in all the senses, is freed from all ills. Dhammapada verse 367, he said, he who does not take the nama rupa, nama, mind, rupa form. He who does not take the nama rupa as I and mine, and who does not grieve over the dissolution, is called a bhikkhu. From these two stanzas, what is the Buddha saying, or what was the Buddha saying? A practitioner is one who will learn to restrain his sense bases. If you are not a practitioner, you are a national average individual, then you will just allow your sense bases to do whatever they want, drive you wherever they want, down the bend, round the corner, everywhere, and you never learn to train to tame the mind. So if you're a practitioner and you hold the mind, learn to watch the sense doors, what you see, what you hear, how you respond to what you smell, taste, and so on and so forth. If you learn to do that, Buddha would say, you are closet bhikkhu. Closet, I add in one. And if in the course of your life, you start to hold this perspective that when you see things, when you hear things, you tell yourself, not I, not mine, it's okay, don't hold on to it. Your closet is getting bigger. You're more closet bhikkhu. You're a practitioner now. So as long as you learn to control the sense bases and learn to let go, as long as you learn to keep telling yourself, not I, not mine, whatever that you experience, it's conditioned, it comes and it goes. If you learn all those things, you are a practitioner. You belong to a community of practitioners. And in this community of practitioner, you can loosely call it the Sangha. It's a community, Sangha, community. An entire section in the Samyutta Nikaya called the Bhikkhu Sutta talks about what makes a bhikkhu. And it is indicated there, all these key characteristics, practitioner who earnestly follow the path, successfully realize Dhamma. A monk who knows decay and death, birth, becoming, grasping, craving, etc., arising, cessation, a way to deathlessness. People who understand the Dhamma, practice the Dhamma, realize the Dhamma. Those are the bhikkhus. So, let's look at the stanza. They practice well. Practicing what? Walking the Eightfold Path. Learning to restrain the sense bases, learning to let go of the I and the mind and the sense of the self. That's what they are practicing. Is of upright conduct. Because of his practice, mind you, he's developing wisdom. What he's seeking to do is to develop wisdom. As his wisdom grows, he becomes, by instinct, a more restrained character. He learned to restrain all his negativities. he becomes a better person. You think about it. Why do you scold somebody? You want to be a good Buddhist, right? You bow before the Buddha. 3 times, 6 times, 9 times. You really enjoy bowing. And you chant day and night because you want to be a good Buddhist. Then the maid brought you the wrong drink, you scold. I want cold, you bring hot. Etc, etc. Why? Why didn't we get it? Because we have not, in that kind of a scenario, it's because we haven't developed wisdom enough. You have performed the rituals, you have gone through the motion, but you have not, your wisdom has not grown. What is this wisdom? Attend subsequent classes. I can't, it's too long. It's a very long. It's not me titillating and trying to get you to come back for round two. It's nothing to do with that. It's just too long, okay? But the point is, if you haven't developed the wisdom, then the trouble starts. That's when your practice, your conduct, you have to remember the 5 precepts because you'll forget. When the mosquito buzz and buzz and buzz and buzz, you will. Why not? You're making my life a misery. So I'm ending yours. You see what I'm saying? We have a problem. If you have wisdom, if there is wisdom that kind of grow in you, then you are restraining not because the precept says so. You're restraining because you're trying to hold the mind from developing and enjoying negativities. You're trying to let that go. You're learning to bring the mind to a balance where it doesn't swing to the extremes. You're trying to bring it to a balance. And so you don't give in to the habits. Okay? Has entered the right path. This phrase, onwards. Nyapatipanno, samisipatipanno, and then the last one, all the three of them tells you that this one is the Arya Sangha, meaning to say they are not just practitioners, they are also practitioners who know what they are doing, has entered the right path. It's got into the stream. They know what they are doing already. So he's practicing correctly. Before that, they are trying. You see that? Anyone who's a practitioner doing well, trying very hard, is allowing that wisdom to help him become a better person. But along the way, he entered the stream. He has entered the right path. He knows what he's doing. So onwards, the Arya Sangha. Yadidang chattari prisayugani atta prisapukkala. 4 pairs of persons, 8 kinds of individual. 4 pairs, 8 kinds? Of course, 4 times 2, 8. Ma. Sotapanna, Sakadagami, Anagami, Arahat. Sotapanna, first stage. You all know this, right?
Yes.
So basically, the four of them, the ones who have seen the path, know how to get it done. And because they walk this path, they have tasted the fruit of that path. So a path and a fruit of the Sotapanna, a path and a fruit of the Sakadagami, path and a fruit of the Anagami, and a path and a fruit of the Arhan. Okay? What does this all mean? These are individuals, the Arya Sangha, individuals with a first-hand account of Dhamma. They tasted it. They successfully went through the practice and then arrived at the destination and got it. Why is that important? Because if there had not been these individuals, then how do you know it works? Seriously, how do you know it works? Someone must get there, got the baton, swing it at you, and go, ha, ha, yeah, patents are out there. The Easter eggs are there. Then you chiong lah. If everyone is an illusionary type of Easter egg, right, don't even know whether God or not, should or God or not, got treasure or not, at the bottom of the rainbow got box of treasure, not, don't know. They have to chong. Chong where? Chong how? You see what I'm saying? Now, Kondanya, you all know, was the first individual in this dispensation to realize the Dhamma, to enter the stream. His achievement was very important. Because before Kondanya entered the stream, not because he's the first Arya Sangha, but before he entered the stream, all you had was the Buddhist word. Huh? All you had was just this man, young man, handsome notwithstanding, charismatic notwithstanding. But all he's saying is, I've seen Dhamma. I've seen Nibbana. Hey, come join me. Then you all chong. Does it work? Because Kondanya got through, Kondanya tasted it. Kondanya turned to his friend and said, yo, it works. Then the other four of them, because they're all good friends, right? The other four says, it works. Let's do it. And then, and it's only one step, you see. Kondanya was just entered the stream. When all the five of them became Arahan, it is so significant an event. Unfortunately, we don't pay a lot of attention to that first five. Because those were the first five in this world, they are the living embodiment of a path that works. If there were not these five, really, how do you know it works? So they personify it. They are living proof of it. And for the rest of us today, in this time, actually, that is why today, I know, a lot of us run around looking for the Arahan somebody. Don't say you are not, because chances are you had or you know somebody who had done so. Yes? Because you're trying to instinctively, subconsciously, not even deliberate. Of course, some of you are just doing it for the karma. Right, you're looking for that karmic, what do you call that? Interest, the boundless interest. Some of you may be looking for that. That's not the point. Some of you are looking for evidence that this method works. And you want to see a living Arahant for yourself. Let's see whether it works. Yes? It's normal. And that's exactly what it means. You had a teacher, he's not going to be around. He taught a method, but the method has to be a life method. That people look at it and say, it works. And for that, you need to see the results. And these individuals, the Sangha, are the results of a method. The Sangha, you are not inspired by the cloth. You are inspired by the practice. You must always remember that. A lot of us will come back again and again to the Dhamma. When you look at some individual, he's a very good monk, he's a very good practitioner, and you will keep going back again and again because you know something pure there, something beautiful there, and you want to be part of that. And even if you don't see it in this lifetime, by your faith, by the joy you derive from the experience, it anchors you to Dhamma. Hopefully, when in your dying moments, that's what you remember. That joyous moment of that association. And then, appearance number two, Buddhist. And these individuals, apart from being a living embodiment, they are the guys who know how to explain to you how to get it done. If you have never repaired aircon, how do you teach the next person how to repair aircon? If you have never seen Dhamma, seriously, how did you teach Dhamma? And these individuals, because they have seen Dhamma, because they know what's Dhamma, they know how to teach, and they know how to guide, and they know how to get it right. Okay? Last slide. These are some reflections about the Buddha that I thought it's worth highlighting for discussion. Hint, hint, afterwards your question, ask around here, okay? Let's talk about whether he was man or divinity. And this has always been a... When you first set out, there's a very good chance that for some of you, when you first set out was just a very short while ago, meaning when you first declared yourself to be a Buddhist. People say, what are you? I'm a Buddhist. For some of you, it was a very recent thing. You just became a Buddhist last week. For some of you, it was a long time ago. But I want you to cast your mind to the point when you started. What are the odds that when you started, when you first started, what are the odds that at that time you really thought Buddha was not man? That he was more than a man, that he was somewhat of a divinity. Okay, no need to tell me, very shy, but never mind, it's okay. No need to be shy. Just because I wrote a book saying he's a man doesn't mean I disagree with you. Okay, there's a lot of debate about this. I choose to see him as a man. Because as a man, his achievements were so much more inspiring. So much greater. Now I'm going into the book a little. You think about it. If he were divinity, if he were fated to realize and teach and unveil Dhamma, then he could well have just sat in a garden and waited. Because it will happen, ma? Because you believe it's fated. Fated means must happen. You sit down there, fated, you must drown, the water will come. Fated. Doesn't matter if it's desert, it will come. But if it were not fated, that it is condition-based. So you will drown, but you're in a desert, water won't come. Chances are lah, condition not there, ma. If we believe in conditions, then the story can be very different. He had to make the effort. He had to struggle very hard. The mental conditions must all be in place. The moon is just right. Nibbana. You understand? So there has to be the correct condition. And we don't end there. You think about it. On his own, realizing Nibbana. We got map. We got version 1, 2, 3. Then got later student come along, add some more. Addendum 3, 4, 5, 6. Appendix 7, 8, 9, 10. Where are we? Still trying to figure out the first map. Yes? A lot of us kept saying, Buddha means what? What is Dhamma? Seriously, what's Dhamma? After trying so hard, listen so long, so many teachers talking to you. Done your own meditation again and again and again. What's Buddha mean, Dhamma? But he did it through no help. Quietly sitting by himself, barely recovering from starvation and dehydration, and figured it out. Saw it. It's tough. To see that is tough. He got it. So that I call it incomparable intuitive wisdom. On his own, it's just amazing. And then, as if that's not hard enough, I now got to teach. Because he chose to do it. He could have chosen to, Suda, done, finish, 回家了. He could have done that, but he didn't. He said, okay, this is tough. It's beautiful, but how to teach? How do you teach? And figured out how to do it. So I considered that a genius educator. He developed a methodology to help another individual see Dhamma. Dhamma, not easy to see. All of you who tried knows it's very difficult. He figured out how to guide you to a point where your mind is ready to see. The trick The trick is to train the mind and guide it to a point where the conditions are just in place and you can see. But you've got to get the conditions just right. And he guided people to do that. Not just that. That's the easy part. If he's alive, he can do it. But he has to have a method that can survive his not being there. Now, you know, you have been part of organizations. The boss is gone, his plan finished. Change of plan. Wan Shui, Wan Shui, new emperor, long live the king. Yes, yes. Like that, no? So, he's not there anymore. The method must still work, cannot be corrupted. Because if you corrupt the method, it won't work. And he came up with something that what I call timeless. Timeless. There's another expression. It's also akaliko. That it worked then, it worked yesterday, it works today, it will still work tomorrow. 2,500 years ago, still working. How many of us own iPad? iPad what already? 10. Every 6 months, one new iPad. The point is, in this time and age, when you keep updating something, version 1, version 2, Microsoft, how many versions? I lost track. In this time and age, when you keep upgrading every 6 months and a year, and this one nobody upgraded. 2,500 years later, you don't touch it, it's fine. The problem is people go and tinker with it and not so fine anymore. But you leave it alone. It's a clock that works on its own. Don't touch it. No need upgrading. And it works for anyone. You cannot sit down there and say, I'm not so smart, I don't understand. We know in the time of the Buddha, there was one individual who couldn't memorize a stanza. What was it, a month? He tried 1 month to memorize a stanza. I'm pretty sure, even though you don't speak Pali, if I give you 1 month, you can memorize a whole sutta. Even though you don't speak Pali. But the poor guy couldn't. So you cannot be dumber than him. But he got it. And you cannot be younger than the youngest person that the Buddha taught. 7-year-old. How many of you 7-year-old here? Seriously? You don't look 7-year-old to me. and then you say, oh, yeah, but I'm very old. Okay? There was one individual who was so old, nobody wants him to be a monk. I kid you not. He was so old. He became a monk in his old age. He was so old. When they say so old, you must remember this is a time when people live until 120, or so they believe. There are no birth certs, so can't prove lah. But it means very old lah. So this individual, they all proclaim to be very old, he must be really old, right? He's the national average 90th percentile, so probably into his 80s. And he realized, he understood, what's your problem? Your excuse, I'm a woman. There are plenty of women arahants. I never studied. They all never studied. So the point is, the method works for anyone. As long as your mind is open, you are prepared to put in the effort for the meditation, you have to spend daily learning to be more aware of your mind. You have to put in place the necessary conditions. Once the conditions are in place, you can wait already. That's when you wait for the Dhamma, the wisdom to arise. Boundless compassion, what do we mean? I said earlier that the Buddha could have walked away. He really could have. When you realize, you will know what it means. You think about it. The world is full of dukkha. So much dukkha. You can see it, you can feel it. It's all around you. This is an enlightened being. He's very happy. He's very light. How do we know that he's very happy? He was very happy. He himself said so. There was a conversation between him and some individual. And this person was saying, hey, why you want to be a monk? Seriously, why you want to be a monk? Okay, by the way, they didn't quite say it like that. It's all paraphrased. Just in case you thought, hey, looking for the sutta that says, hey, why you be a monk? It was all paraphrased, okay? To make it a little bit more modern. Otherwise, the modern audience cannot take it. So the chap, he's powerful, he's rich. So he went to the Buddha and he said, "Hey, Buddha, really, seriously, why you want to be a monk?" Buddha said, I think he used the example of Bimbisara. You know Bimbisara, right? The king. Ah, you know the king, right? Yeah, the king. Yeah, yeah. You think the king will be happy, let's say 1 hour. For 1 hour, uninterrupted, he's happy. No lah, we go like that. Okay. You think half an hour? Maybe half an hour. But maybe not lah. 10 minutes? Maybe. Maybe not. But the Buddha, whole day, no problem. His mind can settle into a state of joy and happiness, uninterrupted for as long as it's just like that. Completely uninterrupted joy. Whereas for most of us in a daily living, we believe that we are chasing after, no, we actually don't believe. We just know, we just do it. We are chasing after joy. And joy is always there, you know, joy is always there. So we chase. Well, once in a blue movie, caught joy, we have catch joy. Because we bought the dress we wanted, huh? So we got it. And then after that, joy ran away off again, and we'll chase after it. So for the most of us, in daily life, we don't experience unconditioned, uninterrupted joy. If you look at yourself, your mind is either restless, or the mind is tired, or the mind is craving after something, or the mind is a little annoyed, or the mind is, don't know what to do, perplexed. And then when the mind is not in one of these states, the mind is concentrating on your handphone, television. So you buy an object, or you get an object to distract the mind, and you lock it there, so you keep the mind mirrored in craving. Or if you watch an awful show, sad, cry, happy. It's like your crying therapy for the day. So, given that he's realized, he's very happy, why did he come back and get himself into all kinds of trouble? You don't forget, now this is Buddha, like, he knows what's coming his way. Honestly, for many of us, knowing what's coming our way, I'm gonna hide in the forest. You want, you come to the forest, see me lah. My address is 3rd tree from left on the garden track. Right? Okay, this is what he had to deal with. He was framed for murder. He was accused of having affairs. His best friends, or not best friends, his good friends were murdered. Seriously? You want to come back to this kind of problem? He will go out and go for arms round, people call you names. You want to come back to this kind of problem? And he's, as I said, he was Buddha. He must know what's coming his way. But he came back. Because he felt sorry for the rest of us. Simple as that. We call it compassion, we call it all kinds of things. But ultimately, it's because he felt sorry for the rest of us. He knew how it's done. He's finished, he's done. That's why in the suttas, if you read the suttas, you keep reading this phrase, let go, put down, the burdens let down. Finish what's to be done. Move on. And still he came back. That is compassion. That is the love that he had, the kindness that he had. Okay? And what was really interesting also, I mean, you see, we are human, right? Yes? Just to be sure. So sometimes the kind of obvious cannot assume, lah, huh? Okay, seriously, but we're all human. We, being human, had this one, what I call habit. We have likes and dislikes, yes? the people we like, the people we don't like, for whatever reasons, we call it chemistry. So when we teach, or when we share, okay, maybe not teach, share. When you share things, when you buy things, when you give things, how many of you give indiscriminately, share indiscriminately? Bola, I like the fellow, I like the face, I give him, no? I don't like your face, don't give you. Because we are human, we are like that. But Buddha, anything goes. You lucky enough, you run into his company, you go into his before him, rich, poor, young, old, awful person, not awful person, it doesn't matter. He will teach Dhamma. The insane, the criminal. I love our celebrated serial killer. Yeah. My students who have attended all my classes before, we know, you know who he is, right? You don't know who he is? He's more famous than Jack the Ripper, you know, in the Buddhist community. We call him Angulimala. That's not a name. Angulimala is not his name. Angulimala was his... title. His brand name. It's like calling Jack the Ripper. Jack the Ripper, I think, is his name. It wasn't his name. It was his killing address. Angulimala was his killing address. People say, you know that one, the one who hanged the what? Anguli, I think, it means finger. Mala is garland. The one who hang the finger around his neck, that guy. Why do I call him a serial killer? Because he kept mementos. Some people will say, oh, because he's counting fingers. He reached 1,000, he stopped. Seriously? He's counting mementos, he's a serial killer. But he stopped. Buddha didn't say, serial killer, I don't want. Just contaminate my sangha. Never did that. It's okay. He can realize, let's do it. So the purity of this man was that if anyone can understand Dhamma, that was the key principle. As long as the individual has it in him to understand the Dhamma, he's coming your way. And he would go. By hook or by crook, he'll make his way there. And this was all the way to the end. Right up to the end. Okay, I can't ask this one as an example because none of you had been there. You're not on deathbed. But Buddha at his deathbed converted one more person. Dhamma all the way to the end. And it's not easy, you know. I mean, look, he's in pain. He was in pain. I assure you he was in pain because he says so. Okay, he was very, very tired. It was a very long walk. He came all the way from Pava to Kusinara. It was a very long walk. He walked the whole day. Finally made it to Kusinara. Took a rest. Someone must go and greet all these lay people who come and say goodbye. And then after that, must go tell the student, hey, please remember the Dhamma, okay? I taught you everything already, but please remember the Dhamma, okay? And then this guy came along. Excuse me, Buddha, can I ask you a question? No, seriously, it was like that. I mean, the sequence as captured in the Mahaparinirvana Sutta was like that. Whole day of walking, very tired, got down to Kusinara, then, hey, please, make a bed, I need to rest. And he sat down. There was one commentary that said that he rested 25 times on this journey. So I make it there, wow, very hot now, India, summer, very hot. So sat down, rested, I need water, drank some water. And then the people, better tell the lay people I'm dying here. And all the lay people come, one after another, there's so many. It's the Malans, they are his best supporters. So they all came, goodbye, Buddha, goodbye, I'm so sad. So many of them came, very tiring. And then come this one, Subhadra, the last guy, excuse me. I got a question. Ananda said, enough. Ananda told Subhadra, enough, he's very tired, let him rest. It is in the text written like that. Let him rest. Subhadra said, but I have a question. Buddha said, let him through. he will understand. Let him through. And so for Dhamma, he did one last one. That's to me, that's compassion, walking the talk. Mindfulness practice all the way to the end. There's a man. He left behind a teaching, you can taste for yourself. And we know it works because there's a lot of people who have benefited from it. So next week onwards, we will talk about the method and we'll talk about how they work, how it works. Okay? Any question?
You mentioned earlier that he's constantly in a state of joy. I really wonder if you can, if you are talking to somebody who is like the Pacharada or whoever, the one who whole family died on the same day, that woman.
Patachara.
Yeah. So, I mean, how do you keep so happy all the time when you're facing such a horrible tragedy? I'm just wondering whether maybe you can switch to neutral.
No, instead of
joy all the time.
No, Buddha joy ma, Patachara not joy. No, you see, when the individual has tasted the Dhamma and seen the Dhamma, two things. One is, in order to get there, the mind is already transforming. The conditions that were possible, that are possible, that make, that are necessary for the arising of that wisdom, the conditions must be there. The mind is really changing. And then when they get to a point where they actually see the Dhamma as it is, I will explain in subsequent lectures what this means. Today, you just take my word as they are. Just take it as they are, okay? So when you've already seen the Dhamma for what it is, the sense of relief. To see the Dhamma, you must have a deep sense of relief, the sense of delight. It's so strong, so intense. It permeates their selves, okay? And then for this individual, as a result of that two things, the transformation experience as well as the final tasting of the Dhamma thing, the mind switched. Now, for the Arahant, the mind doesn't switch back, it just stays like that. For the lower, the ones who have not reached that end state, they toggle between the spiritual experience and the mundane existence. They will toggle between the two. And the closer they get to the end point, the less they toggle. For the rest of us, for the mundane world, we are stuck in one particular type of experience. It will be delight and joy, courtesy of gratification of senses, and then no delight, no joy, but got dukkha because you didn't manage to gratify the senses as you wish. And we toggle between these two. And when you lose someone, the attachment as a result of the loss, the attachment is so intense, it's the attachment that causes the dukkha. Because you hold so tight, it's painful. The one who has realized that holding pattern, the holding is released. It doesn't hold, they don't hold that tight anymore. Because they don't hold so tight, they don't feel dukkha as intensely. They don't and they can't. The mind is irreversibly shifted. Can't do it anymore. Does that answer you?
It does. So when we become very, when we enter the stream, we'll be smiling all the time. So a bit awkward, like if you're nervous and all that. You're smiling.
No lah, you know how to unsmile lah. It is true lah, it's true, can be quite awkward lah. But you can unsmile lah, don't smile so hard lor. But enter first lah. Enter already, come and talk lah. Okay, let me just give you a brief rundown on what we're covering subsequently, okay? Today we covered the Buddha. Next week, we're going to discuss the world as seen, understood by the Buddha. The world as seen and understood by the Buddha. Be surprised how different it is from our world. And then after that, there will be two lessons on, by the word transformation efforts, what I mean is, what are the things that have to be done in order that you, your mind, can dissipate the mental fog? Our mind is shrouded in fog, mist, can't really see, can't really understand. Hear the Dhamma all the time, don't really know what it means. That's a mental fog. And if you go through the practice, I'm spending 2 weeks to talk about the practice to try and explain how to get rid of that fog, okay? Then once you manage to get rid of it, I should change this slide. Once we get rid of it, you are changed. The individual, you, the person, will change. We call it spiritual transformation. So what do we mean by change? What exactly happens? What happens to your mind? Okay? And finally, the last one here, for here, is Dhamma in a nutshell, Dhamma in daily life. The application of Buddha's teaching in daily life. I am going to marry the last two into the last talk. Meaning, Dhamma in a nutshell was not necessary. I'll put it into the Dhamma daily life. Okay?